good afternoon and welcome to the program Legislative Updates. I am Charity Marcus Tanko, your regular host. Today on the program, we shall be looking at a public hearing conducted by the House of Representatives Committee on Healthcare Services with the Ministry of Health concerning the operations and the management of the National Insurance Scheme. The Federal Ministry of Health is accusing the health management organizations of misappropriating funds meant for the operations of the NHIS. This and some other important issues in the National Assembly, I will be bringing your way in this week's edition of the program. Stay tuned, I'll be right back. Following accusations of misappropriation of about 351 billion naira by the HMOs, I am talking about the health management organizations, those saddled the responsibility of overseeing the affairs of the National Insurance Scheme, the House of Representatives set up a public hearing, which was organized by the House Committee on Healthcare Services to look into the issues. And appearing before the committee, the Federal Ministry of Health, in its own submission, advocated that in order for the NHIS to be able to function optimally, that there is need to scrap the HMO. This you will watch as I bring you the visuals of that public hearing. Stay tuned.
Is docile and can be influenced to keep the populace voiceless while their nefarious activities continue unchecked. There is need to let Nigerians know that the era of praising impunity is over and that the change mantra of this administration is not a haze. Ladies and gentlemen, you may recall that on the 8th of December 2016, I moved a motion on the urgent need to investigate the compliance rate of health maintenance organizations, HMOs, to national health insurance contributions, utilization of funds by the healthcare providers, and the inhuman treatment of enrollees.
And I will commonly call the discussion.
Following from the above, the House resolved to 1. Urge the national health insurance to put on hold further quarterly release of funds to the HMOs pending the outcome of the investigation, and secondly, to mandate the Committee on Healthcare Services, that is this committee, to conduct an investigation into the activities of the HMOs and healthcare providers for the past 8 years, with a view to identifying the HMOs, their level of compliance with the relevant provisions of the Act, and determine the reasons for the poor state of services to the enrollees and report back to the House for further legislative actions. This resolution was duly communicated to the National Health Insurance Scheme, and I hope this has been complied with. Furthermore, it has come to the attention of the House and the committee that the operating licenses of all the HMOs had expired long before now and are due for renewal. The outcome of this hearing, among other considerations, we no doubt determine the registration dynamics of the HMOs. Therefore, sequel to the House resolution, today's hearing is very crucial, as our goal today is to deliberate, analyze, and address the reported endless controversies among and between the major stakeholders in the health insurance sector, which are the scheme, the HMOs, and the healthcare providers, and the poor health insurance coverage in Nigeria after many years of implementing the scheme. Consequently, this hearing arose out of the need to investigate the persistent allegations of poor treatment of enrollees by healthcare providers, with the latter passing the bulk of the blame to the HMOs. At the heart of this is the compliance rate of HMOs and providers to the national health insurance contributions and utilization of funds. And it is pertinent at this stage to reiterate that the National Health Insurance contributions disbursed to HMOs are from Nigerian taxpayers. We need to remind ourselves that the federal government established the National Health Insurance Scheme in May 1999 with the main purpose of providing universal coverage and access to adequate and affordable health care in order to improve the health and well-being of all Nigerians. It was also designed to encompass government employees, the organized private sector, and the informal sector, including children under five, permanently disabled persons, and prison inmates. The National Health Insurance went into operation in 2005, and 12 years later, it is yet to cover more than 3% of the population based on available information from the Federal Ministry of Health and National Bureau of Statistics. The report states that the House Committee is aware of the following. The enrollees are used as conduit pipes to funnel revenues to HMOs and healthcare providers. And I'm sure at the end of this sitting, Mr. Chairman, I hope you begin to look at whether it is mandatory that HMO should exist or not, considering that there are some countries. There are many countries that oppress the scheme without HMOs. So we look at the merit and demerit of their existence and see as to whether they still will exist or not. That despite HMOs receiving 351 billion from the scheme since 2005, less than 4% of Nigerians are covered and there are reports of diversion of funds. We are also happy that you are going to look back 8 years and investigate the activities of the HMOs and NHIS and the HCPs, Mr. Chairman. We are really excited about that. That notwithstanding HMOs' receipt of quarterly payment to enable swift payment, the HCPs, the reverse is the case, which is not also acceptable. In the light of this, we are aware that the House resolved to urge the NHIS to suspend quarterly release of funds to HMOs pending the outcome of the investigation, which is okay, sir. To conduct the investigation on the activities of HMOs and HCPs, that is healthcare providers, over the last 8 years to determine a level of compliance on provision of NHIS Act, reasons for poor state of service, access, which are among the issues we look at. But the Honorable Minister has a specific positions which we brought out and his own submission. The Honorable Minister's position are as follows. Access to affordable and good quality healthcare is a key element in actualizing universal health coverage goals in Nigeria. Two, efforts by House Committee to address the challenges faced by Nigerians under the National Health Insurance Scheme is a step in the right direction. And every meaningful health professional or institution should encourage this initiative. The Honorable Minister knows the issues raised by the House Committee and looks forward to a resolution that reduces inefficiency within the system and improves service delivery and elevates patient-centered care. The Honorable Minister also knows that the issue raised under the votes and proceedings appears to suggest the states and local government employers and employee currently pay 10% and 5% respectively as contribution to the health scheme. This is inconsistent with the information available to the Honorable Minister's office. The Honorable Minister also notes that the document appears to suggest that
The 351 billion premium paid to HMOs was geared towards the expansion of the scheme. This assumption appears to be incorrect because the reverse is currently the case. And we give reasons. One, federal government pays between 5% and 5.2% of the consolidated salary as premium for federal civil servants. And you need to put that figure on total income. These funds are deducted at source and paid into the NHIS account. HMOs are paid by the NHIS to provide care for registered beneficiaries under their portfolio. And fourthly, 70% of the funds paid to the HMOs is expected to be transferred to health care providers immediately as capitation. And quite often it is not also the case. A default by HMOs to transfer the funds as at when due is a punishable offense under the Act. And I think that part of the Act needs to be strengthened so that NHIS should have the know-how to punish any HMO who is not complying with the regulations. The NHIS needs to perform better in its regulatory and oversight function and ensure the funds are transferred if the HMOs still exist by the HMOs within a stipulated period.
You go back home to your constituents, who do we see? Who have you left home? The poor, the aged, mostly widows and widowers, women and children, the disabled, unemployed. When they get sick, they do not go to hospitals because they cannot afford to go to hospitals. And that is where the NHIS should come in. Help these vulnerable people have access to healthcare. When I came, I've heard people talk about universal healthcare coverage, universal healthcare coverage. What is that? What it means is that we should cover all 180 million Nigerians. At its core, what it means is that good health care is a right. It's not only a human right, but a tool towards poverty alleviation. I hear people say, UHC, UHC. Give me a break, and I'll give you the correct number. I've had people say 30%, 15%. I have news for you, fellow Nigerians, because I signed the check. The number of Nigerians covered after 12 years is 1.5% of Nigerians. You can quote me anywhere because I signed the check. Countries like Kenya, Rwanda, and Ghana that have less than us in terms of human and capital resource, they're boasting of better figures than us. Why? What have they done better than us? The one thing they have done better than us, they've achieved this without HMOs. Without HMOs. Did you guys hear me? They achieved that without HMOs. And here we are doing this thing, we are going around sloganeering UHC, UHC. It's a joke. If we continue the way we are doing, not in my lifetime, not in my children's, not in my grand-grandchildren's lifetime. It's a joke. I've said it before, I will say it again, and the chairman has reiterated what I said. Healthcare financing in Nigeria that I met is nothing but a huge fraud. It is nothing but subsidy to HMOs. Worse than fuel subsidy. Why is it worse? Fuel subsidy, they cash their checks and leave town. HMOs cash their checks and people suffer and die. This is the truth. You want to hear the truth? Hear it from me. It's been a lie all these 12 years. I see the potential of NHIS to fund healthcare in Nigeria. It's not been harnessed. Nobody has talked over the last 12 years. And the survival and growth of the NHIS has national security implications. Why? Because we cover all our men and women in uniform and our security services. To these men and women, we owe a debt of gratitude we can never repay. They put their lives at risk for us. And their families are out there They go to hospitals, they say HMOs have not paid hospitals. My way of telling them thank you is to make the NHIs work for all Nigerians, especially for these gallant Nigerians. This country belongs to all 180 million of us. We should not allow this crown jewel of ours to be cannibalized and handed over to HMOs. We all see the sufferings of our people, and we see the potential that we can do good. And I have, ladies and gentlemen, I have in my hands, from day one, how much we paid HMOs till date. And I have here, debt, state by state, HMO by HMO, hospital by hospital. Honorable, these are your constituents. These guys are holding their money. We have the facts. I pay the bills. This is not made up.
We're still looking at issues concerning the National Assembly, members of the National Assembly. Like you all know, Legislative Update is a program that is designed to keep you abreast of activities in the National Assembly. Not only in the National Assembly, we're also looking at activities that concerns lawmakers outside the National Assembly. For example, oversight function, constituency projects, and all other activities that involve lawmakers in and outside the National Assembly. On this particular edition, we shall be looking at the call by the Kogi West constituents for the recall of Senator Dino Melayi. They have been gathering signatures, and as at last week, the signatures and the petition were finally submitted to the office of the Independent National Electoral Commission in Abuja. And some of the issues the constituents raised were that Senator Dino Melayi, over the 2 years that he has been in the Senate, that he has not been representing his constituents as he should. This and some other issues they brought to bear when they were when they spoke to journalists. This is how it went. Since Senator Dino Melayi came to the National Assembly as a representative of Kogi West Senatorial District, he has been enmeshed in one controversy or the other. Senator Dino has been having a running battle with the governor of Kogi State, Yahaya Bello, whom he accused of masterminding the recently alleged assassination attempt on his life. Just 2 weeks ago, five people were reported dead after a protest Dino organized in Kogi State turned violent. As if that was not enough, his constituents began gathering signatures for Dino's recall. To drive home their message, 10 people from Kogi West Senatorial District were in INEC office, Abuja, to submit the petition along with signatures gathered for his recall. Speaking to journalists after the submission, representatives of the people said Senator Melayi's recall became imperative due to his incompetence in representing his constituency.
It is over 2 years. And there's nowhere in Kogi West where you can find a constituency office for the senator, where you can even lodge complaints, where you can reach out to him. He has been inaccessible. He has been unreachable. You know, there's no constituency project on ground to show that there's somebody representing us in the last 2 years.
Senator Dino Melayi remain an undistinguished senator until all Kogi West senatorial districts are distinguished. Instead of him to come and develop his people, in every other means he has capacity to do. Instead, he will be in the National Assembly shouting, making noise.
They said they had gathered enough signatures as required by the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
We have come here with signatures of about 188,500 and something. And by that, we have a percentage of 50.1 will have been enough.
Total number of people that signed the records are 188,580, making 52.3% of the total registered voters.
When asked if the governor has anything to do with their decision to recall Senator Dino Melayi, this is what they have to say.
The governor has no role in the election of Senator Dino Melayi and surely cannot play any role. no matter what capacity he's sitting in Kogi State today. He's the governor, but he has a constituency.
Look at him in the National Assembly. He will be shouting that he has the highest motion. Emotions without missions. Sponsors bees. Sponsors motions without fulfillment, without accomplishment.
For now, the die has been cast for the recall of Senator Dino Melaye. If it's carried through, he will be the first federal representative to be recalled by his people since the return of democracy in 1999. While the program is still legislative updates, remember for advert placement and sponsorship, call any of the numbers on the screen. And also to watch ITV. Tune to channel 130 on Star Times, channel 505 on Free TV, UH42 on the free-to-air terrestrial television. And for your comments and suggestions, looking at the opinions concerning the program, you can send in a text message via the WhatsApp number. The number is right there on your screen. Before I finally round up, let's look at our plenary and cuts.
Speaker, my colleagues are from Delta State. I am PDP, and please give me that audience. I want you to listen to me in silence, please. I am coming under the Constitution of the Federal Republic, specifically Section 68 of the Constitution, that stipulates clearly that a member of the Senate or of the House of Representatives shall vacate his seat in the house which he is. Please let me land from sound. And I will read the provision of Section 68G, which stipulates very clearly that being a person whose election to the house was sponsored by a political party, he became a member of another political party before the expiration of the period of which the House was elected. And let me read the proviso. Provided that this membership of the later political party is not as a result of a division in the political party. Please, let me laugh. Mr. Speaker, my colleagues, let me advise this House. Listen to me, please. Listen to me. Just listen to me. Mr. Speaker, my colleagues, the provision of Section 6 of our Constitution have vested the judicial powers of the Federation in the courts. You are mindful of the fact that the Federal High Court has some ruling, but the Court of Appeal did affirm. And you are aware of it that Sheriff is the chairman of the party. Yes. Listen to me very carefully. There is no division in this party. What you need to appreciate, Mr. Speaker, listen. What we need to appreciate here is a disagreement. You will not listen to me in silence. Because the next time you want to speak, I have the also confidence and authority to disturb you also. If you want us to do that, then we can continue that. Make a caricature of the parliament.
I rise on behalf of members of APC and on behalf of the House. As the leader of the House, to use this opportunity to welcome into our fold a former Attorney General, a senior advocate of Nigeria, an indefatigable legislator, and a consummate politician into the fold of the APC. I sympathize and I understand with the minority leader on the depletion, hey, my president,
minority leader, what's your point of order?
is where we draw the curtain on this week's edition of the program Legislative Updates. Keep a date with me next week, same time and same station. I remain your host, Charity Marcus Tanko. Happy Eid al-Fitr.